Good to see everybody today. Thanks for joining us. Sue, Sally, Michael, thank you all for joining MEM today. Very good, very good. This will be super helpful for everybody. 22 ways to help keep our employees safe in 2022. So super excited to do this presentation. Mark Woodward with MEM. I'm gonna go ahead and put my contact information in the chat function here. 573-289-5990 is my cell phone. And my email is mwoodwar@mem-ins.com. We really appreciate everybody taking time to join us. We'll be on our webinar for an hour or so today. You will receive in a follow-up email, this presentation is being recorded. You're going to receive it. You're going to get some follow-up information as well as our checklist that you can use to take a look at your safety plan. What 22 things are you doing and what can we maybe improve on, or what can MEM help with, that kind of thing. So if you have questions through this, please reach out. We're super easy to get a hold of. You got my cell phone number, you have my email. You can reach out anytime. What I want everybody to know too is, if you would like on-site safety meetings, if you would like on-site management level safety training, if you would like on-site safety consultation, we provide that at no charge. So please reach out to us. We have a lot of safety materials out there, such as our seat belt wraps. You can put these over seat belts and tell if your employees are actually wearing their seat belts. Free of charge. The only thing we need from you in return is a written seatbelt policy that's been signed by all employees, and then we'll send you these completely free of charge. One thing that we also have are three-point contact decals. So three-point contact decals for your trucks, we'll send you those. The only thing we need is a written three-point contact policy, and also window clings, seatbelt window clings. So these are resources that we can send completely free of charge. If you have any questions about that kind of thing, just email me or give me a call and say, hey, what ideas do you have for us with regard to safety and risk management? We can help out with that, okay? So we're gonna get started. It's 12:01. Let's get rolling. 22 tips for keeping employees safe, reducing work comp costs, reducing risks for your company in 2022. So once again, Mark Woodward, Missouri Employers Mutual, Senior Safety and Risk Trainer. If you have questions, reach out. My contact info is right here. You are gonna get this presentation later. We are recording it. And what I would ask everybody to do, Arlene and everybody, if you would do this, Mandy, you're going to get an email later with an evaluation. Please fill that out honestly. Let us know what you thought about the webinar series in 2021. This is the last webinar for 2021. Let us know what you thought about the overall program. Let us know about topics you would like to hear about. If you want more information on drug-free workplaces, more information on subrogation and fraud, that kind of thing, please reach out, okay? Let us know in that survey, or just email me with comments or questions. Also, I want you to know that if you want us to do a webinar specifically for your company, we can do that as well. So we can't thank you enough. Thank you for your business. Thank you for everything you've done in 2021. The point of this is to help set the tone for 2022 in your company. The goal is always zero incidents, right? So we're going to talk more about that. 22 tips. Let's get going here. So some things to think about here. The challenge, and I'm a big fan of this kind of thing. I'm a big fan of the messaging with safety. We have to always talk about zero incidents. So when you walk through your shop, when you walk through your storage warehouses, when you walk through the different areas of the plant or job sites, what do you see? Are we talking about zero incidents? We have that mentality, that philosophy in our company, that we're going to do our darndest to go an entire year without something bad happening to an employee or a piece of equipment or having an incident or damage. That's what we need to talk about, zero. Do we have those conversations? So I hope everybody has a to-do list today in front of them. If you have a to-do list, write that down. If you want a copy of these slides, I'll send them to you and you can use them. But start out with this language. Do we talk to our employees about zero injuries? Now, in safety, we're not just concerned about safety at work. Safety people care about their employees regardless. I don't care if you're at work or at home or whatever. I want you and your family and everybody to just be safe in general and injury free. So we're talking about safety at work. We're talking about personal health. We're also talking about safety at home. The tornadoes last week, we need to really be talking about severe weather and winter weather. So we're December 15th, we're talking about severe weather tonight in Missouri. But then we're going to turn around in the next couple of weeks and be talking about frigid, cold, slip, trip, fall type hazards, right? So we have a lot to do with regard to safety and messaging and what we talk about. And some additional thoughts here is, and not to overstress people, but I want you to know that we are having more incidents than what we are officially recording. If you look at Heinrich's incident pyramid, which is a safety theory that we safety people kick around all the time, for every serious injury we have, so that's basically an injury that comes to MEM, you will have 29 first aid incidents and 300 near misses. So just do the math. If you have sent 9 incidents to MEM in 2021, then just do the math. You've had 2,700 near misses that we don't know much about. So we really need to focus more on near misses. So put that on your to-do list. Let's talk more about near misses. And these are incidents where we got close to having a wreck, or we got close to slipping and falling, but we didn't. Nothing happened, but it was still an incident. And if you look at Missouri overall and MEM, we have around 11,000 worker injuries a year, which equates to 3.5 million near misses. And across the state, at 86,000 workers' compensation reports turned in the Division of Work Comp, you're looking at 25, 26 million near misses. Just based on that calculation, is just based on the incidents that we know about that employees actually report incidents, right? So that's something to think about. We got a lot of work to do. So keep that in mind. The safety program is never done. And this is key for 2022. This is absolutely key. I worked with a customer Monday that has a safety program, but it's not really affecting behavior. It's not really part of people's daily lives. It is a safety program that's written, but it is a document that isn't out there with the people. It's not being talked about. New hires will sign it, and then that's it. It's never seen again. Your safety efforts must affect behavior. So think about that. Just kind of reflect on when we do safety meetings, when we have a safety plan, when we talk about the safety plan, when we talk about safety rules, do those affect behavior? I disagree with the annual sign-off stuff because I don't think that's frequent enough to affect behavior. So think about that. You have the written traditional safety plan, but when do the employees actually see that? So write that down, number 3 on your to-do list. Do my employees actually see the safety plan as part of their lives? I would hope so. And remember that people are working. Think about you, our behaviors. We work. We're working. We're task-oriented. We're trying to get things done. We're trying to meet goals. We're trying to just get our work done. We're running up towards the end of the year. We have a lot of deadlines. Do your safety efforts affect behavior and what people do? Because people are working. And I want you to really think about this. Number 4 on your to-do list, I want you to think about this. When you talk to people and coworkers after an incident and you say, why do you think that happened, or what was going on? What were the contributing factors of that incident? People will always give you the human side of things. I was in a hurry. I wasn't thinking. I was trying to get too much done. I was hot. I've been distracted lately. I've been thinking about stuff going on at the house. I just wasn't thinking. Okay. We miss that. We don't take the human element into account when we develop safety plans or we do safety things. We do safety from the HR standpoint or the safety pro standpoint, but we need to think about the human element. So write that down. Think about the human element. How does our safety plan address fatigue and tired and distracted and trying to get too much done or trying to get work done when it's really hot or get people's minds in the game, right? How do we really affect things? And there's risk in everything, right? I wrap myself in bubble tape, never leave the house. There's risk in every activity that we do. Slip, trip, fall is a risk for every person, everywhere they are. Vehicle crash is always a threat and a risk, right? So our safety activities draw down the risk. Now, we talk about zero incidents in a year, and that's what our goal is. We talk about that. And that's going to, hopefully that mentality is going to help us reduce that risk. We want everybody's minds in the game. What things can you do to reduce the risk of incident? And people that say that, well, accidents happen, that's an inappropriate way of basically passing the buck and not taking responsibility. I'm not going to say that about my children, Jacob and Joseph. I'm not going to look at Jacob as a 17-year-old driver and say, Jacob's accidents are going to happen, and I'm not going to just accept that and just let him go out there. I'm going to do everything I can to protect people. So we're going to eliminate that kind of language. What can we do to affect risk, right? So let's think about that. What things can we do to draw down risk, right? Because people are working. They're out doing their job. And when was the last time those folks saw those safety rules? When was the last time management actually enforced them? And are those safety rules part of daily life? I don't know. That's up to you to determine that. When was the last time employees saw the safety plan? When was the last time management enforced those safety rules? Is anything documented? One thing to think about too in a to-do list, on your to-do list, is we don't give ourselves enough credit. I know that you're talking about safety, but we don't document it. I talk with a lot of employers that say, oh yeah, we do our safety meetings, but we just have a hard time getting it written down. There is no proof, written proof. Written proof is so valuable, right? Anytime you talk about safety, document it. Okay, what did you talk about? Today we're gonna have a rough day, it's muddy, but we gotta get this done. We gotta get this part of the building framed. I know it's drizzling, but let's think about this work at an hour at a time. And let's not try to kill a bear, but let's try to get what we can done today without something happening. That's a safety meeting. And you need to document that, please. Keep a big file folder of safety training sign-in sheets or whatever you call them, and just document that, right? So I put this picture in here. It's just a random photo of construction job site. And I'm going to tell you, with regard to risk and a safety, as a safety pro, there's not much I can do a lot about this. Think about the hazards that are always around us. And let's talk about these things. Gravity, fall from heights issues, where we have rough terrain or maybe some leading edge issues. We've got, how can I walk across these job sites? I'm going to do what I can, but I still have inherent risks like gravity, right? So what we have to do is think about this. People still have to adapt. People still have to be aware. They have to pay attention to each step. They have to pay attention to each tool they pick up, what their hands are doing. They have to, their personal decisions matter. Their health and resiliency, right, matters. In our work, we have to be healthy and flexible and able to move through these job sites, use tools safely. Our decision making is important. Drug-free workplaces, all that helps us adapt to rougher working conditions or more demanding working conditions, right? So let's think about that. These things are very important to be able to adapt to rougher working conditions. So, and I'm going to ask you, and you know, what is your level of risk tolerance? That's a term that we toss around, risk tolerance. What are you willing to give? What is your company or your employees, what are you willing to give? And I'm going to tell you, people don't like when I say this, you can do whatever you want. You don't have to do a single thing that we're recommending today. And I lead safety meetings, and it's really funny because I'll walk up in front of a group of 25 construction employees, and they do framing or concrete or trenching, and I'll say, you don't have to do a single thing that we talk about today. Because you're going to get in a work truck and you're going to be gone and you're going to drive and you're going to be by yourself and nobody's watching you. You can do whatever you want. What are you going to give up by avoiding or not following these safety rules? You could give up your fingers and hands and eyes and your health and your ability to make money for your family and your ability to provide for your, that's what the risk is if we do nothing. Are you willing to do that? Some people are. Yeah, some people are. The company, what are, when we talk about these safety rules, is the company, the management team, willing to enforce them? What's management's level of risk tolerance? Maybe management doesn't want to enforce these rules. So you have to make that decision, because the 22 topics that we talk about today all demand that management care and pay attention. I can't help you if management won't do that. Can't help you. That's where it all starts. Okay. Then once management cares and pays attention, then we work that down to individual employees. Folks that are on the call here today, so we have all of you, I want you to know that we appreciate what you do, that you have taken time, that you are showing interest, that you care, and you logged into this webinar because you want to make sure that 2022 is successful and injury-free, and you need to congratulate yourself for that. We appreciate you. We applaud you. So the purpose of the safety program, and this is really wild too, this is just a thought from a random safety guy here, but I do run into situations where safety people are so focused on compliance that we miss the fact that all of what we should be doing, everything about safety in your work should be to protect people from injury, period. The compliance and all will happen. And the 22 rules that we talk about today will help you with compliance. And in fact, if you do them really well, OSHA's not going to say a word to you because you're not going to have the incidents. And if they do a file review on you, you're going to have everything covered. So the number one goal here is to protect injuries, protect from injuries, which results we enjoy the fact that our company is financially more stable, more productive, right? So number one, we protect people, but we enjoy these benefits, right? And then we toss around another term called loss prevention. So loss prevention to us, this is important, is the fact that the acute injury occurred or the incident occurred, right? The incident occurred, which we need to prevent through safety and risk management activities. The incident occurred and it slipped through. But then also what also hurt us was the fact that financially we had a bunch of cost associated with that incident. So two things, the acute incident, but also how much did it cost? What I encourage you to do is look at all lines of insurance, not just work comp. So MEM, we specialize in workers' compensation, but you have a lot of different types of insurance. Arlene with the city of Sedalia. The city of Sedalia has many different types of insurance. What are the costs of all those insurance and how many claims have occurred against them, right? So there are trucks that we damage a fender and they end up in the body shop or they end up at the city shed to get repaired, but it doesn't really. So we even need to look at those as well. Those damages that didn't necessarily end up in insurance, but we still had to pay for them. So that takes a lot of work. And let's keep moving. We want to address primary concerns. This is really big. Primary exposures, primary hazards. And you need to, on your to-do list, really think about what is most likely here to result in an injury. Falls from heights, vehicle crash, strain, sprain, slip, fall. And are we addressing top types of incident, right? So that's some things to think about. We have to address top types of loss first and then compliance. A side thing here to think about is I have read lots of safety plans, right? And I think it's wild to see that we haven't really addressed fall issues. We haven't addressed slip fall issues or vehicle crash, but we have addressed hazard communication. Everybody panics and loses sleep over safety data sheets, but we haven't addressed how people are really injured. So think about that. Let's focus. Loss improvement and risk improvement. These are more terms. So at MEM, we try to do two types of visit. If I come out to visit your company, Joe McDonald, if I come to see you, I'm focused on two things. Loss improvement, which is, what are we going to do to get the injuries down? The frequency and severity of the injuries. How many injuries occurred? How bad were they? Let's get that down. Let's bring the losses down from 13 to 9 or 9 to 4 or from 4 to 0 in a year, right? Let's get losses down. But then there's risk improvement, meaning, Joe, you drive all over the KC area. You got cars and trucks and vans everywhere. We haven't had a vehicle crash, but we have significant risk. We haven't had anybody fall from the rafters, but we have significant risk in that, right? So let's look at what our people do. Slip, fall, strain, sprain, motor vehicle crash, falls from heights, and let's address those. let's get the losses down, but let's also address risk. Just because we haven't had any losses in that area, we have a lot of risk and it could happen. And we know cost. We've talked about this, the experience rating. When these incidents occur, the cost of the claim is calculated into the experience rating. And that's going to hurt. Remember, if you're a smaller, if your premium is around $35,000, $20,000, $24,000, $12,000, the average lost workday claim is $61,000, $62,000. So that's very volatile. One injury could cause that mod to go way up and almost double your premium. So small companies that will say traditionally, well, we're too small. Do we really need a safety plan? We're so small, there's only 5 employees. One incident will double your work comp cost. One. So this is tough. Small companies have a lot of pressure on them. Okay. In this case, this company's paying basically $120,000 more than they should for workers' compensation. That's a lot of money. That's a full-time employee or 2 or 3, depending on what's going on. Now, this is where I also talk about low mods and how you can still keep pushing. So if you have a low mod, congratulations, but how low can it go? This particular customer is a 0.89 mod, but they could be as low as a 0.63 minimum mod. They're still, even at a 0.89, leaving $37,000 on the table. So let's keep pushing for zero. Let's keep pushing for zero. Right? So on your to-do list, what are our costs? We know that injuries have a long tail. Every day that we go safe, we have a safe day is a blessing. We understand that, right? Every day is very important. Please don't get complacent. Keep doing safety messaging. In 2022, we have to do more safety messaging. Okay. Honest, open communication about safety on a regular basis. Every day is a blessing. And if we have an incident today on 12/15, it will not go away until 2026. It's very important that we think about every day. Every safe day is important. So let's keep moving. It's 12/21. We're about to enter the lightning round. I break every safety plan into 2 portions, and we've talked about this before in other webinars, but I hope this is helping. I hope this helps you. And you need to let me know. Okay. Every safety plan I break into two main chunks. One chunk is what activities are you doing before the incident to actually affect behavior and prevent the incident? All right. What are you doing before? Well, we do a safety meeting every year, and you know, are these things actually preventing incidents? Do you even want to? I don't. So before the incident, so getting the safety rules out there, knowing your cost, doing the safety meetings, actually going out and observing work and enforcing safety rules, doing the write-ups to correct behavior or corrective action, whatever you want to call that. This is before. So I'm going to ask you to look at your safety plan and say, what am I doing that's a before thing that actually prevents incidents? Because I'm going to tell you, at MEM, your paperwork and your record keeping doesn't matter to us if it's just a thing that's done to placate people. It's not. And also with OSHA, it's not going to help you. I'm not going to help you with DOT. We will know when safety meetings are occurring just to do safety meetings. I can spot them from a mile away. Real performance before, right? Now, the other half is what happens. Do you have a plan after an incident to control the cost, loss control, loss prevention, loss control? So after the incident, do we have company direct medical? Are we doing drug testing? Do we do an actual incident review, incident investigation? Are we communicating with the injured worker like we should? Are we communicating with MEM? Do we use MEM carrier services? No matter what insurer you're with, they have services like telemedicine, Corvell, that kind of thing that will help save you a lot of money, right? So that's it. I need you to analyze those things. What are you doing before the incident to prevent the incident? Is it documented? And then what is your plan after an incident to get people treated and back to work, light duty, that kind of thing? What is your injury management plan, which we've talked about? I also do this. I look at your offensive safety measures. What are you doing to go out and project safety into your employee base and make have an effect? Then I also look at what are you doing to control loss costs. So when an injury occurs, let's say it could be a $3,000 med-only claim with OCMED treatment, a drug screen, and that employee's back to work. But we fumble the football and that doesn't happen. And a $3,000 med-only claim becomes a $23,000 lost time claim because we fumbled the football, right? That's what we're talking about there. And then I need you to also on your to-do list, make a note to, I want you to go back and look at your previous injuries. And I need you to ask a couple of questions. Number one, why did the incident occur in the first place? And this is a neat activity Flint and I talk about. How many incidents would have been prevented if one safety rule would have been followed? So go back and look at that. I want you to go back. Don't just close claim, put tape over the file, throw it in the file cabinet. I want you to go back and look at that and say, what could have been improved? Number two, I want you to look at the cost. Why did a $3,000 claim become a $23,000 claim? And then I want you to put your lessons learned down. Very important. It's going to take some time. And I really want you to do that. Let's look from the previous losses and try to improve. And then one of the things I also think about too is, let's be honest. I want you to look at your departments, your department heads, your foreman. And I want you to really think about this in terms of what has been going on, but what's going to happen in 2022. What real safety activities are actually occurring? Are safety meetings occurring like they should? Are they being documented? Are you enforcing safety rules? Are your people wearing PPE? Are they not wearing PPE? Why? Are they wearing seatbelts? Are we doing anything to verify why injuries occur and why the costs are high? Because with that particular employee that's injured, if I went back and looked at their safety meeting records and safety enforcement records and inspection records, what was going on with that employee? When was the last time that employee actually had a safety meeting? I don't know. And then number two there, why are the costs so high? I really want to know what's going on with injury management. Do we have a plan? So these are things to think about. This is the 1-2 before after thought process for safety plans. And I hope they're helpful. You need to let me know. What do you think about these things? Okay. Now, if you have questions, please put them in the chat function too. You can always put that stuff in the chat function. You can email me after the session. Please stay in touch. You've got my cell phone number. You've got my email address. Don't ever hesitate to reach out and call and just say, hey, what do you think about this? I'll try to help you as much as I can. Okay. So we want to really try to help. So. All right, now, the moment you have all been waiting for, this is the 22 things. You will get a checklist of sorts. You will get all 22 of these things in a PDF document that you can download, and I want you to use them as a checklist. If you have any questions about these, call me. Now, if it's 12:27, so wish me luck. Can we go through 22 things before 1 o'clock? I hope so. We're going to give it a shot. 22 things. The before. This is the safety plan. Top and middle management must commit. When we discuss corrective action, are they willing to support you in addressing unsafe acts, conditions, behaviors, that kind of thing, right? Does management know how much is being spent on workers' compensation? Does management, and I'm talking about not just top management, but middle management as well, foremen, supervisors, managers, do they understand their rights, your rights as an employer in Missouri workers' compensation? Do they understand experience rating? Right? Do they understand what happens if claims are not submitted in a timely fashion, the negative repercussions, right? Do they understand the Missouri safety penalty and Missouri drug-free workplace penalty, right? These are rights. So one of the things I really want to offer everybody on the call here today is we will come in and do a series of management training for your management to explain these things. Your rights, roles, and responsibilities in workers' compensation and safety, which will help. So let's educate top management to get more support, right? I do run into a lot of situations where management really has no idea what they pay for all lines of coverage. And they really have no idea what they're paying on these different claims, right? It's just something that's handled by finance, right? And if we're assuming that everything's okay, right? So let's talk about that. I want everybody to understand costs, which we've talked about, experience rating. And this is an activity you can put in your to-do list. How much do you have to sell to offset a 1.24 experience rating? How much revenue do you have to make? How much work do you have to do in order to turn right around and write a check back to MEM for that increased premium? I don't know, but I need you to do that. How much work do you have to do? How much do you have to bill out in order to take that profit, that extra $30,000 in profit, and turn right around and write a check to somebody else? I'd rather you not do that. MEM does not want that. Okay. Number three, develop, communicate, and enforce written safety rules. Many of you have written safety rules already. So they're developed. We just need to get them out there to employees. Please remember the communication part is very critical. When was the last time the employees read through the safety rules? Okay, it is not fair to put a 99-page safety plan out in front of them and make them sign the last page. That they nobody in their right mind would think that's effective. The key here is enforcement. If I'm not wearing my safety vest out in traffic, how do you handle that, right? If I'm not wearing my seatbelt, what does management do? Now, this goes back to number one, right? If top management won't support enforcement of safety rules, then that's a big problem, okay? Because I start to think about these things and say, well, why bother? They don't even have a safety plan if management won't enforce it. It actually brings a ton of additional risk liability to your company, right? Get those rules out there. Make them part of people's daily lives and enforce them, please. Number four, hold regular safety meetings and provide training. We understand it. You're doing your safety meetings, but here's the thing. Double down on them. Okay, please just be honest and upfront with your people and chat with them, care about them, and get out there and talk with them. Okay, and I don't have to have hour-long safety meetings. I say have a safety meeting, everybody thinks it's an hour. You don't have to. I can do a safety meeting in 5 minutes. Wear your seatbelt, sign here, five seconds. I don't know how long I need to talk about seatbelts with employees, but I'll spend the time, but I shouldn't have to talk much about that. Wear your seatbelt. Here's corrective action that'll occur if you don't. Number four, also, I want to get back to this. I don't believe annual safety meetings are effective because it doesn't make any of this part of daily life. And I want you to double down on your policies. We always do the annual policy signature. But when we have key critical safety rules that affect people's lives and they could die if they don't follow these rules, I'm probably going to get more. I'm gonna have them sign it a lot. I don't know how much, but I'm gonna have them sign it a lot. We're gonna keep signing it until we get it right. Okay. So I don't agree with just and if I get called in for safety meetings, if you call me and say, Mark, will you come in and do safety meeting? I want you to know automatically I'll ask, please send me your safety plan, which I will fully read, and then we will review that safety plan. I will review it with the employees, and we will specifically talk about the hazard, you know, that the safety meeting, the hazard that we talked about in the first place, right? So that's what we do. So get out of the mindset of the annual thing, please, because the signatures and that safety plan should drive down losses. If we have a safety plan that isn't driving down losses, something's wrong, right? Performed a documented corrective action. If somebody is not following safety rules, it is your responsibility to fix that. We say corrective action. I will sometimes slip and say disciplinary action. I don't care what you do. Just have a conversation with the employee or fix the hazard, whatever you need to do. But if you fix a hazard, document it. Also, what we're really not good at is documenting when we replace older equipment and we bring in a new piece of equipment. Okay, well, unit six over here didn't have a lot of guards on it. And, you know, we've had unit six for 30 years and we've been lucky, but we've got a new unit that's a lot more efficient, has a lot of safety features that are going to make things a lot better. Take a picture of unit six, take a picture of the new one, and make a little file up or make a little write up that says specifically what was improved. And give yourself credit for that. What did you improve? If you take out old equipment, put in new, give yourself credit. Documented corrective action. Please get with employees. And if you talk to employees about a safety issue, document that, please. Number six, inspect work areas, tools, buildings, and vehicles. This, I'm telling you, is we don't do this enough. When was the last time we went out and actually looked for hazards? Now, this is where you take time out of your day to actually go out and look for hazards. Okay, go out and find hazards and then make a plan to get them fixed. Not everything, we can't take care of every single thing every day. But what I look for, or that same day, but what I look for is what is most likely to get people hurt. Slip, trip, fall, strain, sprain issues, water on the floor, people not wearing seatbelts, right? People texting behind the wheel of a company vehicle, right? Go out, and we say inspections, go out and just look. I heard the term yesterday, management by walking around, which I think is really weird because that's where we tell each other that we go out, we need to go out and walk around and talk to our employees. And I get that. I understand it because we get so wrapped up in our desk work. We need to go out and see what people are doing. And I want us to go out and see what's going on from a safety standpoint. So that's number six. Go out and see what's going on. Find a hazard, get it fixed. Number seven, enforce a drug-free workplace policy. We've talked about this before. New hire screening and post-incident screening. We've talked about this before, post-incident screening within 24 hours. But talk about it. Don't leave it to an annual thing. Make it part of the safety meetings. We're a drug-free workplace. If you can't follow those rules, maybe we're not for you. You will have increased risk if you're doing this and coming to work, okay? Develop a written seatbelt policy. In the chat function, please. There are 73 folks listening today. Will you please send me a chat? There is a particular statistic that MEM has mentioned over the years, for many years. It's not a good statistic. It has to deal with the number one. Why does MEM require that all of our customers have a written and enforced seatbelt policy? Can somebody put that in the chat function, please? Put that in the chat function. Why does MEM require a written seatbelt policy? Anybody want to give that a shot? It has to deal with a number one. Mark says seatbelt save lives, and you're exactly right, Mark. You're exactly right. But let's get back to the number one. One. What does the one represent? Sally says it's law, and you're exactly right, Sally. Heather says it's the highest type of injury, and Heather, you're so close. It is the most common way to be killed on the job as an employee in Missouri. It is number three in terms of lost workday cases. Yeah, Justin, you're exactly right. If you have people that drive for your company, we want them to be wearing seatbelts, but we also want you to have a written seatbelt policy that's enforced. Yeah, Kathy, you're right. It's the average lost workday claim on a motor vehicle crash is right at or maybe a little over $100,000. So it's very, very important that we have this, okay? Yeah, Deborah, right. It's the most easy to follow. Please, the vehicles all have them. You're right. Develop a written distracted driving policy. They're saying in Missouri that up to 80% of all motor vehicle crashes that happen in this state have distraction as a contributing factor. If your folks are texting and driving behind the wheel, they're gonna crash, they're gonna hit somebody, and that's gonna draw liability into them. They could be personally sued, and also that could come back on your company, because if it's company business they're doing over the phone, then that's risk for your company, right? So get rid of the distractions. Number 10, provide new hire safety training, because up to 40%, now this is wild. Deborah and everybody, this is wild, Kathy. Up to 40% of all of the claims that come into this company a year. So 10,000, so what, 4,000 injuries that are submitted to MEM are folks that have been employed or been in that position for less than a year. I hope everybody has a new hire safety training plan where we sit down and we do not hand the new hire a big, thick safety plan, but we hand them safety rules that they can follow on one page. We make it helpful and easy to achieve, and we regularly review these with employees, and then we watch them. And then lastly, and also very important, is the post-offer employment physical. So MEM has a partnership with Select and WorkSteps, and we can help you create a plan that helps you verify whether or not a prospective employee is healthy enough to physically do the physical demands of that job. We call it avoiding hiring your next work comp claim, because we're going to verify that this prospective employee is actually healthy enough to do the job, right? So that is something we have on our website, okay? So that's the 11 things. And I want you to take this list when you get it by email and reflect on what you're doing. And I want you to score yourself on each of these things. And on each of these 11 things, they have to be, you may want to write this term down, effective. Are they driving down injury frequency, and how severe the incidents are, and are they helping you address risk? Or are we just doing things just to do them? Please don't do that. Do things just to do them, okay? It's 12:40. I have 11 more topics to talk about. Does anybody have any questions? If you have questions, feel free to put them in the chat function. It's super good to see everybody chatting in. Very cool. Really appreciate everybody and what you're doing. Thank you very much for spending time with us. So this is the before in the two-part safety plan, the offensive tactic. So now we're going to go to the after, the 11 things that we need to do to be prepared. Okay. And here they are. Number one, can't stress this often enough. With every company, I will see safety plans, but in the safety plan does not actually clearly state when and how an employee is to report an injury. In your company, is there a policy somewhere that says that employees must report injuries in writing to their supervisor before they leave to go home from the end of their work duty? Then that supervisor is supposed to take that information, get it to the claims contact in your company. You're supposed to get that to us within 24 hours. Your company provides company directed medical, light duty. We do drugs. Also, we do drug screening within the first 24 hours. Right? That is a written injury reporting policy. We make the assumption. Everybody says, well, if you have an injury, you know, you're supposed to report that immediately. Well, immediately for me is way different than immediately for other folks. I'm busy. I have training tonight at 6 p.m. I'm going. Immediately to me is when I can catch my breath and get a chance to call my boss, which may be well into late afternoon tomorrow. I don't know. Immediately means a lot of different things, a lot of different people. So clarify that, please. Second thing, it's very critical, direct medical care. Do employees and supervisors know that if an injury were to occur, that you have identified a Concentra or a Barnes Care or an OCMED clinic that is within MEM's provider network, right? That all injured employees are to go there. Now, you need to think about rural locations, emergencies, night work, when maybe some of the OCMED clinics aren't open, right? So directing medical care is very important. You may want to put that in your injury reporting policy, that if something were to occur, we go here. and you are not allowed to just run off to an ER and rack up a $10,000 bill without calling us first. At least call us. You have our cell phone number. Call me, text me, email me. Let me know that you're having an issue. Also on Saturdays and Sundays. How do we handle it on Saturday and Sunday, right? So think about that direction of medical care and being clear with employees that say, you have to call us. You can't just run off and do this. And when we like directed medical care to providers that are skilled in orthopedic injuries and also understand a work comp system, right? Number three, post-incident drug and alcohol screens within 24 hours. Very important. My question to folks about this is, how often are we talking about it? Do your employees actually follow this? But also, how do you feel about being 100% responsible for an injury when our claims adjuster may call you and say, yeah, we got a drug screen here and it says that they have methamphetamine in their system. So you will be fully, you will pay for that fully unless you have an enforced drug-free workplace policy, right? So you have to have the drug-free workplace policy, realize that there is a 50% penalty that we can take up to 50% penalty if you have an enforced drug-free workplace policy and the employee screens positive, right? So realize you have rights. You can protect yourself, okay? And we can explain that more if you want to get a hold of me later, okay? So post-injury drug and alcohol screens within 24 hours are very important. Perform an incident investigation of all incidents and injuries, all incidents and injuries. Investigate for several reasons. Subrogation, liability, yada, yada, yada. But what can we do to prevent things? Also, odd thing to think about, how many incidents are in the work comp system that are actually not work comp claims? They shouldn't be in the system. An employer's paying for them, but they were never investigated. Report injuries to the insurance carrier within 24 hours. That's standard. Please report those things to us within 24 hours. Don't wait. We see late reports all the time, and it just adds costs and hassle. Please. Know and utilize carrier cost savings programs, no matter who you're with. If you're with MEM or whatever carrier you're with, study the website. Talk to your agent. What programs do we have, like telemedicine, Orvel, safety plans, safety grants, right, that you can take advantage of and save money? Document when treatment is declined by the employee. That's an employer right, or that's something that we encourage you to do, is that you offer training, but the employee didn't want it that day. Now, all that does is document that you had that conversation. The employee can get treatment, work through you, and maybe tomorrow they come back and say, yeah, I'm having a little pain. I'd like to go get looked at. That's fine. That just documents that we talked. Okay, please, whenever you talk about an injury, document that. Offer light duty to employees. All right, in the chat function, everybody, it's 12:46. NCCI made a change a few years ago that gives folks a discount in how claims dollars are reflected in the experience rating when a claim is kept med only. So you know there's three types of claims: report only, med only, and lost time or indemnity. Lost time is exactly that. The employee lost time and MEM had to pick up the payroll. Or indemnity is they had some sort of a surgery or fracture or something like that, right? Settlement at the end. So med only claims are very important. So NCCI will give you a reduction in how that claim is reflected in the mod. So if it's a certain dollar amount, you will get a percentage of a reduction there. So can anybody tell me what the percentage is? To keep a claim met only, what is the percentage of a reduction? Why is it very important? Why will it help drive your mod down? Why will it help get people back to work? Why will it help reduce hassles for you to keep claims met only and have a light duty program? Can anybody put in the chat function, what is the reduction? Shannon, you're super close. Super good to see you, Shannon, too. Very, very cool. And I want to come back, too, so keep that in mind. You're close, Shannon. Anybody want to give it a shot? Shannon's close, but she's not right. It is actually 70%. 70%. So that those claims dollars are reduced 70% because NCCI wants to wants everybody to offer light duty, and they're putting their money where their mouth is. And they say, you keep it light duty, you keep it med only, you offer light duty, you get people back to work, we're going to give you a 70% reduction. Okay, so light duty is key critical to getting costs down and getting people back to work and healthy, right, and back to work. So number 9 is plan for injuries and emergencies at night or in rural locations. Think about that. Emergency treatment, night treatment, rural locations, have a plan. Keep that organized. Don't just let it go off the rails in what would turn a $3,000 claim into $23,000 just simply because we didn't have a plan. Construction companies, this is very important. Number 10, communicate with your injured employee often. You can talk to your employees. Tell them the plan. The easiest thing to do is give them the injury management plan, the injury reporting policy. Tell them that if something happens and we submit an incident report to MEM, MEM is probably going to call you. They're going to send you some things through the mail. It's no big deal. It's just the way it is. Here's my number. Call me and just be open and honest about it. There's nothing to hide with this. Okay. Communicate with your injured employees. And here's a thing to think about as part of your training plan. Do we ever actually explain what work comp is? We toss around the word claim. Well, you submit a claim. It's really an injury report. If it's a report only, it's an injury report. There's really nothing going to happen with that. It's first aid, medical, med only. We go see OCMED treatment. It's $1,500. We pay the bill. The employee's back to work. Hey, there's nothing really going on with that. It's not very complex. Now, the indemnities, bone fractures, surgery, that now it does get more complicated. But explain to people, as when you're doing your safety meetings, explain what work comp is. Sally, the answer is yes. The answer is yes to that question, Sally. Yeah, you can talk to your injured employee. It's just when they are represented, we can't. We have to work through representation through that. But yeah, you can. Open, honest, truthful communication. Last thing, number 11, communicate with, and I'm going to tell you, Sally, this is interesting. What we hear and what we see is the most common reason why employees seek representation through the injury process is because they feel that people haven't talked with them. They don't know what's going on. They feel confused. They may have not, you know, so one of the things we have to do is talk to people, let them know what you're going to do. Okay, let them know what your plan is. Okay, talk to people. It's when we don't talk to them, when we have these communication issues, that was where we see that. Number 11 there, and the last thing, 12:51, I'm ahead of schedule. This is a miracle. It never happens. I want you to always communicate with MEM often. Talk to us regularly on every open work comp claim. Talk with your adjuster. You can call. I worked for an MEM policyholder before I actually started working with MEM, and that was kind of my game plan because I was not a work comp expert. I kind of was learning as I went, and I always called the claims adjuster. And I said, this is what I think we ought to do, or this is what do you think we should do? And we always talk back and forth. Realize that you pay us for these services, and I want you to take advantage of them. Don't hesitate to call in, okay? Call in, talk to the adjuster, and ask. You can call me as well. I can get you hooked up with, you know, if we need to, or get you some answers, okay? So the last thing I want to end with is I want everybody to have a Merry Christmas. I want everybody to have a Happy Holidays. I want to thank everybody for your business. I want to thank all 73 of you for logging in today. Okay, I hope this was of value. Always know that you can reach out to us. Okay, every MEM employee you can reach out to. You have my cell phone number, you can reach out to me, and we want to help you. If, when it comes to improving safety plans, helping you in 2022, driving these injuries, the frequency and severity down, reducing the risk, that's what we're here for. MEM has a very strong safety group of safety professionals. Get a hold of us. You have your consultant that works directly with you. You have folks like me that are in special projects and in safety training. Always reach out. And now this thing about let's go, this is where it is. This is what we're going to end with, which is I want you to go forth and think about performance and doing these things in the offensive tactic. So my challenge for you today, before we leave, I got 7 minutes left here, is I want you to think about Christmas coming up, the New Year's holiday. I want you to think about, get a safety message to your employees. this week or before the end of the year. I want you to send something out. I want you to do something now. I want you to have that plan for the winter. And I want you to start getting stuff out right now about what's going to happen in 2022. This is performance. This is about action and activity. And what things are we doing that we can physically show with documentation that we're doing to reduce those incidents? Let's go. So I want to see you in 2022. We're going to do webinars again. If you would like something specific for your company, let me know. Be safe. Thank you very much. Take care, everybody. If you have questions, holler. Okay. Take care, everybody. Thank you. Have a great 2022.